going to be the subject of what we're going to talk about, but I know what I'm going to do is I'm going to tell you a story, and then we're going to finish the story and figure out what happened at the end. But stick with me through the story, and then we're going to talk about how minds change and why facts don't tend to work. So one morning in the spring of 1954, there was a woman, Dorothy Martin, who lived outside of Chicago, and she fancied herself as a bit of a psychic. She would receive messages and have automatic handwriting. So one morning she awoke and was receiving a message, and it was feverishly writing. She could say the handwriting wasn't hers, the words weren't hers, and she was receiving a message from Jesus, now going by the name of Sananda, living on the planet Clarion. And Sananda told Dorothy to gather fellow seekers, they call themselves seekers, to hear their message. So she did. Over the summer, she had a few followers, it progressed into the fall. Sometime in August, she received a message that the world was going to end.
What year was it?
1954. So she received a message that the world was going to be destroyed in a global flood, and that Sananda and the other guardians, the other aliens, would arrive in their flying saucer to save them all on December 21st. And it was written up in the local paper, and a psychologist, Leon Festinger, was reading his morning paper with coffee and saw this and thought, huh, I wonder what will happen on December 22nd when the world doesn't end. So he had his fellow psychologists, grad students, and so on, infiltrate the group and follow them for the next few months to see what would happen. So, stay tuned. Alright, so what we're getting at here is the nature of beliefs. Now, this concept is actually difficult to define. The most basic definition would be something that you accept is true. Right? It doesn't have to be true. But if you believe it to be true, then it is part of your system of beliefs. Beliefs help us understand the world. They are models of reality. They allow us to make useful predictions. And we act on our beliefs. Whether they're true or not, they're true to us. And so it makes sense to act upon. And we get our beliefs in a couple of major ways. So one of them is our personal experiences. I have found as a critical thinking instructor that one of the biggest hurdles to thinking critically is recognizing the limits of our personal experiences to inform us about the world. Now, certainly they are telling us something useful, because if not, we would be dead. But they can't always be trusted. So for example, when I was a kid, I must have been about 5 or 6. My grandma was sleeping next to me, and I woke up and felt this fingernail going up my arm, just like really slowly. And I woke up to see what was happening, and I saw this old woman. She had long, straggly white hair, and I tried to yell to my grandma to wake up and help me. And she covered my mouth, and I tried to yell harder, and she covered my chest. I can still feel her hands. I mean, they were cold. But to this day, I won't sleep with my arms outside of covers. Okay. Does anybody know what that is?
Right? Sleep during the day. It could be a few things.
Well,
you know, hallucinations.
Yeah, so sleep paralysis. I still suffer from this. Anybody else had sleep paralysis? It is terrifying, especially if you don't know what it is. So basically, when we're asleep, our brain shuts off the motor neurons to our body so that we don't act out what's happening in our dreams. So the mind is awake in sleep paralysis, but the motor neurons still aren't turned on. Now the problem is, your brain is freaking out, like, why can't I move? And so we insert an explanation that makes sense to us. And that explanation makes sense to us based on our previous experiences, what we learned about how the world works. If you live in a culture soaked with aliens, it could be an alien abduction. If you live in one, there's history is full of art paintings with like demons and succubi holding down the chest or ghost or whatever. In my case, it was the witch from Snow White and the Seven Dwarfs. Right, I was a kid, that was the most terrifying thing my young brain could think of. Honestly, she was scary. But if I didn't know what that was, I could still to this day be convinced that ghosts are real because I saw one. How do I know homeopathy works? I tried it, and I felt better. Right? We're constantly using our personal experiences to tell us about the world. The problem is we can be misled. Okay, so personal experiences are one. Another one is what we get from others. It could be parents, it could be clergy, it could be educators. Quite frankly, it could be mostly people we trust, right? So our history, throughout human history, we spent most of that time in small groups, in tribes. We trusted our tribe, we had to. It meant our survival. So, to this day, we're still a tribal species. We just don't live in those small groups anymore. So who do we trust? Who do we include in our tribe? It depends on what aspect of our identity is being triggered. All of this happens in a background of trust. A lot of our beliefs are just based on trust. I know, for example, that the Earth goes around the sun. I don't know that because I've seen it. I don't know it because I've done the math myself. I know that because other people I trust have worked all that out, and I accept it. This means it's really important, though, to trust trustworthy sources, right? To trust sources that are known to be reliable. And so, like, these days, we have a lot of people trusting sources that aren't necessarily very reliable. So all of our beliefs work together to form, like, a web. So if you consider the web, at the very center are our core beliefs. Those are those things that are really important to us, to our identity, to our social group. And those are connected to other beliefs, right? All these nodes are interconnected. They form how you think the world works. You can't just take one of those beliefs out. It ruins the whole web. So when we're trying to think about how minds change, we need to realize how those beliefs are connected to other beliefs. You can't just take something out without replacing it with something that makes sense to that person, that makes a cohesive whole. And not all of our beliefs are the same. I find this category to be really useful, this categorization, in terms of beliefs that are evidence-based and those that aren't. And what I mean by that are things that are falsifiable or not falsifiable. Have you heard of these concepts before? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so these are important, but I find with students really difficult concepts. Basically, can you prove it wrong? If you can't prove it wrong, it's not an evidence-based belief. If you can't use evidence to show something isn't true, then any evidence that seems to make something true is useless. Evidence has to be able to be used to disprove something. So for example, subjective beliefs. I hold that cats make the best pets. Am I right?
Absolutely.
It is objectively true. I could have evidence for it. I could say cats are quiet. They're self-cleaning. I can leave him home for a longer period of time. You know, in Massachusetts in February, where there's a foot of snow on the ground and it's cold and dark at 5 o'clock in the morning, I watch those suckers out there with dogs thinking, my cat is so civilized. Okay, so, with as much as I have evidence to support this belief, it's an opinion. The thing is, though, a lot of the things we feel most strongly about are subjective. But what we do is we find the evidence that we want to maintain that belief. So we need to recognize for ourselves that we're really deceiving ourselves in this process. Just almost everyone. The power of vague statements is what we impart on it. They don't actually say anything. Their vagueness gives us the ability to give it that power. Supplements in the United States, I don't know how they work here, but in the United States, they're not allowed to make specific health claims because they haven't been tested for those. So what they'll say is, supports a healthy immune system. That seems great, right? If I'm scrolling through the supplement aisle and it says supports healthy immune system, oh, I mean, that sounds awesome. But it doesn't say anything. And then there are the supernatural ones. Supernatural claims are, by definition, not part of the natural world. There are caveats to this, of course. So if I said, if I make the claim that God flooded the entire earth 6,000 years ago. Now, the flood is falsifiable. We should be able to find evidence for a global flood. Even if we have that evidence, which we don't, but even if we did, we could never say the cause of that was God. That's not the falsifiable part. Okay, so recognizing which parts of our beliefs can be proven wrong and which can't be proven wrong. Okay, you've all seen this, right? Who sees the dress as blue and black? Who sees it as white and gold? Is that right? Okay, you've all seen this, so you know that other people see it differently than you, but it's really fun to get students in a room together and go, wait a minute, the person, my husband and I have had a lot of conversations over this because he sees it as differently than I do. And so, you know, fighting over the color of the dress. It's a dress, and it's the color. Think of how basic this is. We disagree on the color of this dress. The interesting part here isn't, the point here isn't necessarily to convince someone of why you see a certain color. Like, you're wrong, this dress is blue and black. I don't know why you see it in white and gold. You're just stupid and you're wrong. Instead, think, wow, you see that differently. I wonder why. Let's explore that together. What is reality? Now, this is the dress. Imagine now inserting politics and ideology. We think we see the world as it is. That's a concept called naive realism. We think we experience the world as it is, but we're just getting a subjective interpretation of it. If we want to know what reality is, the power is in allowing diverse perspectives that are seeing it differently and exploring those together. It offers multiple testable hypotheses, but only if you listen. Taking this one step further, I love this meme, because they're both right, but they're both wrong. So to get to the truth, we have to lean into the disagreement in a productive way. When I was a kid and I saw the ghost, it's because what I expected to see. We often say that seeing is believing, but often believing is seeing. So in the United States, World War I, we have planes, and then World War II, we have people are flying, and there's an idea of going into space. For the first time in all of human history, there was a possibility of humans leaving the planet. People started to get really excited about what could be out there. And then there were movies with flying saucers. Is it any wonder that people started to look up at the sky and vague things that I don't know what it is and go, ah, flying saucer? There was a culture that was primed to see flying saucers. One step further today is that we all have our own realities online. If you're scrolling through your newsfeed, the person next to you could have an entirely different newsfeed. Your choice is you choosing what kinds of news you want to see, the sources you want to see that from. I like this, I don't like this, I agree with these people, I'm going to include them in my filter. All of that then, the algorithms learn you and go, well, if I want to keep you on this site longer, I need to give you more of what you like. My social media feeds have all figured out that what I want to see is cat videos. perception of the economy. And writing it up between people who are on the right and people who are on the left. Now, what happened here? That would be an election. And here? And here? Like, it literally switches completely opposite. The economy did not change overnight. People's perception of it changed overnight. I don't like the guy in power, so the economy now sucks. Versus, I like this person. The economy's going great. Really basic levels of perception. So when we're talking to other people, we need to remember that their realities might be completely different.
Is there something special on the left that they happen to agree with each other?
Now there was so this is interesting. Polarization didn't really start to increase until probably like the 80s and 90s, that's probably history that's interesting but not worth going into. But this one here, that would be George Bush. W. Yes. Do you know George Carlin?
Yes.
Okay. Have you ever noticed anybody driving slower than you is an idiot? Anybody going faster than you is a maniac? Your speed is great. Right? This is naive realism in a nutshell. My beliefs are the right ones. I have thought about them. Anybody who disagrees with me on this side is wrong. This side is wrong. Naive realism essentially boils down to when somebody disagrees with you, you try to explain the facts. Here's why you're wrong. And I'm right. That doesn't work. God, they must be stupid. All right, so let me try again, right? Mocking this time. That doesn't work. Well, they must be stupid. When we think about our thinking, I think it's useful to, this is a Jonathan Haidt's system. Do you know this metaphor? The elephant and the rider. So it's similar to the economy system 1 and system 2, but I just think it's easier to understand. So imagine in your brain, you have an elephant, and then a rider sits on top of the elephant. Now, the elephant is really powerful. It's always on. It's below your conscious level of thinking. It's emotional. It's biased. It's tribal. The rider is the part of your brain that's capable of rational thought and logic. And it's the part most of us think is us, right? The smart ones. The problem is that the rider, instead of controlling the elephant, elephants are hard to control. Usually what happens is the elephant uses its emotions and biases and so on and just suggests something to the rider, and then the rider goes, yeah, that's right. Here are all the reasons why that's right. So the rider ends up acting more like a lawyer for the elephant. It's like the PR department. Instead of controlling the elephant. Okay, this is going on in your brain. It's also going on in everyone else's brain. So we think in a conversation that my writer is talking to your writer, but actually it's my elephant talking to your elephant. The writers are just finding reasons for why the elephant is right. But there's something underneath that that's motivating what the writer is, the justifications the writer is coming up with. So it's in our best interest, not just for ourselves, but talking to others, to dig down. What is the elephant doing here? Why is it leading the writer in that direction? The overconfidence cycle can be the result of this then. So in the overconfidence cycle, motivated reasoning is, those are the emotionally driven justifications to find reasons for why we're right. The more it's important to me, the more it's attached to my identity, my emotions, the stronger I feel about it, the stronger motivated reasoning is. Motivated reasoning helps you find those justifications. And then confirmation bias kicks in. That is the tendency to continue to support what you already think is true. You find evidence for it everywhere. You give it more weight. You remember it more. All of that then leads to you being overconfident in your position. Of course I'm right. Look at all of these reasons I have for why I'm right. Overconfidence is really dangerous. Because when you're overconfident, you're not going to change your mind. You're not going to learn. You're not open to other possibilities. So be wary of we think we're reasoning, but we're actually rationalizing. So in reasoning, this is what we think we're doing. Our writer is following evidence logically to a conclusion. But usually what we do is we start with the conclusion that our elephant wants to believe. And then we use motivated reasoning and confirmation bias to find the evidence that we need, however poor it is, however unrepresentative of the whole body of evidence is. But then the result is we rationalize our position and we're probably pretty confident about it. And we're more motivated to defend beliefs that are important to us, to our identity, and to our social identity. If there's an us, there's a them. And what ends up happening is that tribe trumps truth. Our standing in our social groups becomes more important to us than actually finding truth. We want to be a good member of our tribe. It is much easier to disagree with people who aren't in the us than it is to disagree with people who are in your group. That's your tribe, that's your seat. All right, so what happened? Okay, now, they thought the world was gonna end. So, they gave away their money. Some of them lost their jobs. They lost custody of their kids. A lot of them are doing Dorothy. I mean, why would they need that stuff? The world's gonna end, right? So, they, in preparation, they collected their sacred books, which are Dorothy's writings. They also, they were told that the any metal would interfere with the like flying saucer field or something. So, like, they removed their zippers and their crowns and like underwires. They got all ready. They were told, though, that while the end of the world was December 21st, they could come at any time. So they were told to be ready. Now, on December 17th, they got a phone call from Captain Video from Outer Space, who said that the aliens were coming that afternoon. I think it was at 4:30. Get ready, take off the metal, go outside, and be ready to be saved. So they did. They got out there, no aliens. They failed to note that that was apparently a popular TV show at the time, and they were being pranked by a radio station. Okay? On December 18th, the aliens are coming back. Got ready, went out, no aliens. All right. But they knew that the date was December 21st. The aliens tested them, they were ready to go. So on December 21st, this is coming through Leon Festinger, right? His people who didn't filter it. I mean, they were tense, they were silent, they were finally going to be justified. Like, they had been mocked, they had been ostracized, they had lost basically everything. And this was when they were finally going to show everybody that they were right. But they'd been waiting for it was finally going to happen. Now, at midnight, there was no aliens. At 12:05, there was still no aliens. But somebody noticed that the clock was wrong. At 12:10, Dorothy got a message and she announced that there was a slight delay in plans. At 2:20, still no aliens, but she got a message that they should take a coffee break. We did. At 4 a.m., they're sitting around staring at each other, stunned silence. What is going to happen? What is going to happen? Now I'm curious. You know the aliens. What do you think they did? Does anybody know this story?
I realized like the year was wrong.
Oh, the year was wrong. Okay. Does anybody think they're going to change their mind?
No.
Yeah. So, she got a message that the world was not going to end because their belief and dedication had saved the world from the flood.
Oh.
That's brilliant, right? Not only were they right, they had saved the world. Actually, this is when they got so sure about their belief, they went out and proselytized, right? We saved the world from a flood. Come join us. This is from one of the professors who followed her, who lost his job, and I think he lost his kids. He said, I've had to go along the way. I've given up just about everything. I've cut every tie. I've burned every bridge. I've turned my back on the world. I can't afford to go. I have to believe. GMO or something that's triggering, they're not going to be. This one is untriggering. The story I just told you is not triggering. So for example, if I were to do this exercise, I might start with something like, how many species of elephant are there? Anybody have a guess?
Two?
Six? You're out of number here. Okay. Where did that belief come from? This would be, did it come from a first experience? Did I hear it from somebody? If I heard it from somebody, is that a trustworthy source? The reasons for believing, okay, and you can dive into those. How could you figure out if it was true? Number five is really important here. How could you feel if you were wrong? By the way, all of these graphics I have in here are available on my website. How would you feel if you were wrong? How would you feel if you were wrong about the elephant species? Okay, that feeling right there is the feeling you want to lean into with other beliefs. Because when I tell you what the answer is, you're like, oh, that's cool. It's three, by the way. There used to be two, the African and the Asian elephant, but the African elephant was split into two, the savanna and the forest elephant, with genetic evidence a couple decades ago. That raises another interesting question, which is, facts can change.
Yeah.
Right. So even like the number of elephant species, oh, and it's also more complicated than that because there's subspecies, there's pygmy elephants, there's, right, it's more complicated than we think it is.
And that's a definition changing
effect. The number of elephant species have always been the same, but yes, how we perceive it or how we measure it is different. I skipped number one and I really shouldn't have, so let's go back to that one. The percentage of confidence. How confident were you in your original answer? Okay, so put it on 0 to 100. And do this with all of your beliefs. Put your confidence on a spectrum. Avoid 100 and 0. And then allow yourself to change with evidence. If you're talking to somebody else who disagrees with you, you could do something similar. So you could say, well, you think that you're 90% sure that there's two species of elephant. Okay, that's cool. Why aren't you 100%? Now, I didn't ask you why you thought you were right. I asked you to come up with your own reasons for why you might be wrong. You can't change someone's mind. They have to do that themselves. So that prompts them to think of their own reasons for why they might be wrong. It's probably not going to be an instantaneous change, especially for a belief that's really important to them, but you plant a seed. I also want to add one other thing. If you want to change somebody else's mind, the price of admission is the ability to change your own. Right? You have to be willing to change your mind. Model the lack of overconfidence. Model critical thinking. Right? Model that to others. Allow them the space to change their mind. And be willing to change yours as well. So I communicate on thinkingispower.com. So instead of there's too much to know, instead of knowledge is power, thinking is power. I have social media accounts. My bigger one is Facebook. So if you want like a daily-ish dose of critical thinking, you can go there. And everything, all the graphics I shared around there as well. Thank you.
Yes.
Didn't the Jehovah's Witnesses leave the world to come to the end in 1940? It's still around.